Gobi paratha, masala matar dal, badam bari bangan, hari mirch achar, and kela lassi. Now, what do all these dishes have in common? Well, they all sound somewhat familiar, and yes, you probably have had a variation thereof at your home, and yes, they're all vegetarian. But what these dishes share with one another, and with literally thousands more, is a new definitive cookbook called Lord Krishna's Cuisine, The Art of Indian Vegetarian Cooking by author Yamuna Devi. This book is definitely definitive, about 800 pages worth, but it's also startlingly light. Light in the sense that all the recipes pay particular attention to that which concerns us most, fat, cholesterol, calories, and roughage. The author has spent about 10 years compiling the information for this book after a return from India, where she traveled extensively and cooked for and with an amazingly varied cast. In addition, Yamuna Devi, formerly Joan Campanella, was the lead singer of a band in London in the early 60s, which led to a collaboration with former Beatle George Harrison. In addition, Yamuna Devi also pioneered a food relief program in Bengal in the early 70s, which is in operation to this day. We caught up with this extraordinary woman here in New York last week, where she was preparing for a food presentation at Fortunoff's.
The next thing you'd be doing is actually cutting one in half here, and then squeezing it over a bowl so that the juice comes out. Put it in a strainer so we save the juice, and then we get all the seeds out that way, and then just give it a nice dice so it's perfect ready for matar paneer with a little fresh mint in it. Wouldn't that be splendid?
Very nice.
It'll work out just very well.
So you cut it in half and just squeeze it over a sieve.
Squeeze it over a sieve so all the seeds come up. Because what's bitter? The seeds. Seeds will destroy this dish. So if you get Italian plum tomatoes and you want to use them in a jam in a pinch, where you wouldn't really want to use them at all, but if you do, be sure that you just squeeze out the seeds so you save the juice. If people that take a whole tomato and put it in the food processor, they know you're going to get that bitter twist to your dish. Now we're going to be making a sondesh, several kinds of sondesh. And to do that, we're going to soften it by putting it in the miracle food processor rather than having to bray it by hand. We're going to be making several kinds of sondesh today. And this machine, of course, functions beautifully. What does in a few seconds what you would have to work on for quite some time using the palm of your hand, braying it across the countertop. Because the paneer was slightly dry. But paneer, I'm hoping, turns into what Japanese have for tofu in this country. There's such a versatility with paneer, big protein value. And this country needs paneer. I hope that in 20 years, paneer is to America what tofu is today. We have about 20 years to catch up, I think. But Indian cuisine and paneer will very definitely catch on with the American public. It's a wonderful protein food. I came across Indian cuisine quite by accident. It was my sister's wedding. And I simply got an invitation in the mail. Please come to my wedding in New York City at such and such a time. So upon arriving at her residence, she said, we're going to have lunch tomorrow at an Indian Swami's house. So I said, all right, why? This sounds like fun. And the next day I had a lunch that was the most memorable meal in my life, because I'd never tasted anything like it before. And I think the way it was served, I'd never had anything like before. There was an ambience in that room, meeting this person, that I had never experienced before in my life, my first 25 years. I came to India first in 1970. But what led up to that from 1966 to 1970 was a great desire to go to India for a number of reasons. To study the culture, to see Vaishnavism practiced in India, was something from 1966. The minute I met Bhaktivedanta Swami, I wanted to see where he came from, where his roots were, and to see what happened to me. So I think from the very moment I met him, I wanted to go to India. But life's demands don't always, they're not always fulfilled when you want them to be. So it took some time. After leaving the United States, I met him in 66, went to London in 68, lived there until 1970, and wasn't until the fall of 1970 that I actually came to India for the first time. And then from India, that is an extraordinary story. Landing in Bombay, and for the next 2 years, I should say from, 1970 through 72, it was traveling the length and breadth of India, sometimes for a fortnight, sometimes for 2 or 3 days, living with Indians in their home, camping out in tents, attending melas, and trying to understand the heartbeat of the people. This cooking is part of a tradition that goes back nearly 5,000 years, evidenced in the Shastras, in the Vedic literatures, in the Puranas, in the Mahabharata. This cuisine that we are calling Lord Krishna's cuisine is in fact a tradition from all different areas, north, south, east, west, central. And it takes a multifarious number of forms. It can't be boiled down so simply. It's a very broad and expansive subject matter. But to simplify, I have called it Lord Krishna's cuisine because the essence of it is to please the Lord. It is bhakti. When I arrived in London in 1969 with my husband, we had heard everyone knew George Harrison, everyone knew John Lennon, everyone knew Ringo Starr, and everyone knew Paul McCartney in the world. In fact, today, probably they're still the most popular recording group of the century. But we decided, we had a little small group, 6 people, who had been practicing devotional songs in the process of our bhakti. And we thought, why not get the Beatles involved? And so we decided, how are we going to reach them? It's an impossible feat to catch their attention. So every day we decided to make an apple dish, some kind of an apple dish, and bring it to Apple Records. And so we brought every day. So first it was just the office staff that became a little interested. And then it went up a floor, till it reached the top floors. And then we thought, well, nobody is mentioning. Of course, the staff loves these things. And so, for one reason or another, one day we stopped. We got a telephone call because we put our telephone number name the apple dish. And so we got a telephone call. Where is our apple prasad? Where's our apple dishes? So from that, we struck up quite a friendship with George Harrison. And of course, in the course of time, he had us sing, and Nanatev said, I want to record. So we did a 45 first, and Apple sent us on promotion, and miracle of miracles, it was number one in Czechoslovakia before the next 3 months are over, and we're touring Germany, France, and Netherlands, doing television, all this business. So it was quite an exciting period in our lives. For all of us, and the fact that it was devotional songs made it even more exciting. I mean, when do devotional songs get to be on the pop charts? Not very often. So here we have the Brahma Samhita 5th chapter on the pop charts, a very interesting subject matter. But it was the chemistry of the time. Namaha, I first met Indira Gandhi in 1972, and that was through a then Member of Parliament, Dr. Janmira, a dear friend. And I was part of a party that was sent to invite Indira Gandhi to a function, a cornerstone laying temple ceremony. And as it is, she became very fascinated with my interest in India and India's culture, and particularly in my study of Vaishnavism. And I met her several times over the next 2 or 3 years, and we had a very nice friendship. Sometimes I would arrange to bring her very special prasads that were from foreign countries even. And she would take a little taste and we would chat. But she was a wonderfully thoughtful woman, so preoccupied and busy with her work. But sometimes she took the time out, which was very difficult, to inquire into my study of Indian culture. And that developed our friendship, I think. While I've tried to keep intact tradition, it's very important. Otherwise, why bother to write a book? So I've really tried to preserve what we have in the regional cuisines. But we also find in the regional cuisines oils that are used in those areas. South is coconut oil. North may be till or peanut oil, sesame oil. There are many different oils that are used in Indian cooking. And we use ghee, we use oils, but especially in this presentation, there is quite a reduction in the amount of sugars, oils, chilies, and I should say masalas in general, in terms of the quantity, just toned down, but not enough to ever lose the dish, the character of a dish or a preparation. Scientifically is the way this book was written, because when I started writing the cookbook, I had no idea what it would entail. I think if I had, I wouldn't have begun. But in fact, it was an exciting project because I learned more and more and more with every refinement. But initially, I would take a dish that was famous in India, say, paneer matar, and I would take that dish and try to think, what area am I going to pull out here? What is it buttressed with in the rest of the book? Then start pulling out flavors and reducing others, testing it sometimes 2-3 times myself to find one that I thought, oh, this will work. Then I would have 2 kinds of recipe testers test the dish, a total novice and an experienced cook. See what they did with the recipe the way it stood. Find its weak points, find its strengths, and then write it again. So at least they were written 2-3 times. This is a perfect time for this kind of cuisine to be presented to the Western world, not only America, but everyone is so much fascinated by health. This is the health, a decade of health. The 70s, the 60s, the 50s, the 40s, they all led up to now. And the burgeoning interest in fresh produce, in grains, in legumes, in seeds and nuts are undeniable. It's not only on the coasts, New York, Los Angeles, and Washington, and Seattle, and crisscrossing down to Miami, and up to Vancouver. It is in middle America. It's throughout the country. People want to eat healthy. And not only vegetarianism 10 years ago, it was still a laugh, but now many people are adopting a vegetarian diet for a number of reasons, health being one of them. So I am very excited to see this book come out at exactly this time. This book is a stepping stone for a lifetime presentation of Indian culture and Vaishnav practices. I feel that this is just the very beginning, even though it took a long time. I now work with an association in Reston, Virginia, that's whole goal is to present the Vaishnav culture to the Western world. I want to see a museum of the highest quality presented in the capital city of our country one day, so that people can come and study with wonderful audio visuals. This is just a beginning, and by working for Bhaktivedanta Swami and trying to carry on his tradition, I feel that there's no limit.
Lord Krishna's Cuisine, The Art of Indian Vegetarian Cooking by author Yamuna Devi, has received rave reviews from book critics and culinary critics the world over. The book, published by Bala Books and Dutton, is now available in your local bookstore.
Stay tuned now for Vision of Asia News coming up next, followed by You and Your Money, a financial segment with advisor Deepak Gulati.
The preceding segment on Indian vegetarian cooking was brought to you by House of Spices, manufacturers of Lakshmi brand products.